radicals in general are highly unstable intermediates. However, there are two reliable trends in carbon radical stability that are analogous to trends in cation stability that we can take note of. First of all, increased substitution around the radical center increases the stability and lowers the energy of the radical. Because more substituted radicals are more stable than less substituted ones, they are more likely to be formed as intermediates in radical reactions. In a later webcast, we'll see how this stability trend can be exploited to selectively add HBr across an alkene in an anti-Markovnikov fashion, opposite the trend for HBr addition involving cations. The second trend involves electron delocalization. More delocalized or resonance stabilized radicals are more stable than radicals not involved in resonance. Delocalization lowers the energy of filled molecular orbitals, lowering the energy of the radical overall and increasing its stability. In addition, an important point to note here is that resonance imparts radical character to multiple atoms in the structure, which may lead to product mixtures. Until this point, we've talked only about carbon-centered radicals, and you may be wondering about trends in radical stability as a function of atom type. When considering radicals centered on different atoms, however, it becomes critical to examine the origin of each radical. In other words, we have to look at the stability of the bonds that broke to form the radicals. Bond dissociation energies, or BDEs, provide a direct measure of the likelihood that a two-electron bond will break to form two radicals, a process known as homolytic cleavage. A lower bond dissociation energy indicates more favorable homolytic cleavage, and in general, larger, more diffuse atoms exhibit lower BDEs than the smaller second row atoms. Thus, larger atoms such as the halogens and silicon generate radicals more easily than the second row atoms. If you take a look at the table shown here, you'll notice that many of the bonds that have been used to generate radicals historically, such as BRBR and II, have notably low bond dissociation energies. The first step of any radical reaction is the generation of a small amount of radical from an even electron species called a radical initiator via homolytic cleavage of some kind. Let's look now at a few examples of initiators that are commonly used to start off radical reactions. Peroxides contain the labile OO bond, which can break homolytically to give two alkoxy radicals. The alkoxy radical is able to abstract hydrogen from organic substrates, generating organic radicals that then participate in radical reactions. The lengthily named azobis isobutyronitrile, or AIBN, is an interesting substrate in which two bonds break homolytically. The CN bonds on the left and on the right of the azo group, which is the NN double bond, both break to yield a molecule of nitrogen gas, which is lost, and two radicals in which the radical is adjacent to a cyano group that stabilizes it by resonance. The kinetic loss of nitrogen gas drives this reaction nearly to completion. You should also note that in this drawing I've omitted two arrows, those arrows going back to the carbons on which the radicals reside. You'll sometimes see these arrows omitted because they're implied by the red arrows that I've drawn here. Finally, the elemental halogens such as Br2 and I2 are commonly used to initiate radical reactions. Under the influence of light or heat, the BRBR bond can break homolytically to reveal two molecules of bromine radical, which, like the alkoxy radicals generated by peroxides, are able to abstract hydrogen from organic substrates to initiate radical reactions. One important point to keep in mind for all of these is that generating the radical is an endothermic process in all cases, and so an energetic input of light or heat is necessary in order to initiate the reaction of the initiator. In the next webcast, we'll take a detailed look at radical chain reactions from initiation all the way to propagation and product formation. It all begins with small amounts of a radical initiator, which goes on to react with one of the substrates to kick off the radical chain reaction.